Born in Beirut, Lebanon, in September 1945, artist Seta Manoukian grew up in a multicultural society. She spoke Armenian and French at home, Arabic at school and with her friends. This early exposure to different cultures formed the basis for her unique perception of the world. Lebanon, renowned for its unique cosmopolitan character, is a melting pot for 18 distinct ethnic and religious communities trying to coexist in this small nation. The history of the Manoukian family goes back to Antalya, Turkey. Seta's great-grandfather was an Armenian Orthodox priest. Armenian culture is deeply rooted in Christian tradition, the religion first embraced by Armenia in 301 AD. Seta's grandparents met in Aleppo, Syria. Her grandfather devoted his life to taking care of Armenian orphans who fled Turkey and walked through the desert to Aleppo during the Armenian genocide in 1915.
Took care of the orphans when they came to Aleppo. He was running the orphanage besides being the pharmacist.
My mom's mom, she was really a beautiful woman, very tall. And she was very artistic. She did needlework on silk.
Satinik Azajan's best needlework is part of the art collection at the Musée du Louvre.
My two grandmas together, they are very different from each other, but each one in her way was exceptional.
Seta's father, Avidis Manoukian, had a large aluminum factory. He also loved art and encouraged his children to be creative. He was always a kind and loving father. Seta's mother, Astrik, a well-educated woman, read to her children Armenian poetry and introduced them to Armenian music. That was how Seta learned to appreciate her Armenian heritage.
I used to love dancing. I was dreaming of becoming a ballerina, but I could not because later I grew too tall.
Determined to continue dancing, Seta joins the Armenian folk dance ensemble. There, she falls in love with her tall and handsome dance partner, Haik.
We were always dancing together because he was tall like me. This is in the bus. We went to Jerusalem to dance, but I was a solo dancer. I was only 14, but I was so tall that with some makeup, they thought I was older.
I was completely taken by that music, completely. I mean, I was like the whirling dervish in them when I was listening to Armenian music. So it left some trace, so it's coming back in my work.
Seta's early drawings reveal a sense of composition, a strong hand, and an original talent noticed by her first teacher, Paul Gregosian.
I used to have an art teacher coming to our house. He used to come every day because he was very enthusiastic about his student.
At the age of 15, Seta wins the first prize at an art competition organized by the Italian embassy. She is sent to Perugia, Italy for 3 months to study art. At the end of her stay in Italy, Seta's father enrolls her into the Accademia of Belle Arti in Rome.
Italy was the most joyous time. I loved Rome. I felt like my mom's home, if you wanted Rome. I was painting a lot, and I was reading a lot, I was dating a lot, I was sleeping a little bit. I wanted to stay forever.
After 4 years in Rome, Seta returns to Lebanon. She finds herself in the center of Beirut in the 70s, full of life. She goes out to parties, dancing and skiing with friends. Despite all the fun, she feels something is missing.
I was in quest of something else, and I knew it was a spiritual experience.
When I wanted to paint, I locked myself in my room. And I started painting whatever was in that room and myself in those mirrors. There were plenty of mirrors in the room.
Seta becomes aware of her thoughts. She feels her thoughts are fleeting and impermanent. She goes deep inside before she starts painting and discovers emptiness, a detachment from the ego. She feels she's only a witness of her own movements.
The walls start getting very high. Then I started painting parts of myself, like a leg inside the room, one foot, or a hand, or a shoulder or something, just parts of my body, as if I was the witness of what was happening in that room. I was part of it, but not completely in it.
Seta spends hours at a cafe in the center of Beirut, the meeting place of intellectual youth, talking with other artists. The intellectual climate in Beirut is stifling. It makes her aware of grave political problems facing her country.
I was listening to this injustice happening. The Palestinian problem, the other part of the African problems. I was taking everything like it was personally happening to me.
The feeling of burden and uneasiness brings forth the idea of horizontality in Seta's work as a condition of non-action.
I was feeling very heavy. The burden was very heavy on me. So I was painting the white benches.
Little by little, the paintings become lighter. Details of a human figure start coming out from under the heavy bedsheets as if trying to get liberated.
And slowly, slowly, they become lighter and lighter, purer and purer. So it was a purification process for me.
I started painting the streets of Beirut. I started feeling the same as people. I felt that the whole country is passing by the same trauma as me. And they are connected with their environment and same time disconnected from their environment. It was this feeling of people going each one in a different direction, and I had the feeling that it's going to start. Something is going to start. It's like somebody who cannot breathe anymore. I was feeling so bad about everything. And then one day I opened the drawer. And there was in the drawer this book, 2-3 pages. I don't even know the title, but it was saying that everything is one. And he was explaining mathematically that everything is one. I didn't understand anything about the mathematical part of it. And I closed it and put it back in the drawer. And I went to sleep. The next morning, my mind was so clear. I was in bliss. And joyful and loving. It lasted 3 days. I was in love. And it looks like everywhere was so much light everywhere. And my mind so clear and joyous. I was going to fly these 3 days. I don't know what, until now I don't know what it was. And then the war started there after that, right away.
Sense to you?
War is the same as peace, but only it goes faster. In a single day, there is hundreds of events instead of during peace. It happens every 3 months, what happened in one day during the war. All the ingredients during the war are there during peace because the violence is there, greed is there.
only thing that is a little bit different that there is no masks during the war. During peace, everybody has a mask. During the war, everybody goes all the way what he is or she is inside. People that want to help other people and be of service will do it. During peace also you see that life is a tragicomedy, but during war it's there. The tragicomedy is there and you cannot not see it. So you are laughing your head off sometimes. I started teaching in the Lebanese University. The war gives intensity to everything. So it was giving intensity even in the teaching.
I was always with the Lebanese artists and we used to drink coffee and smoke and talk and drink coffee and smoke and talk all afternoons.
When I actually came in contact with your work, I realized that you were probably one of the few, if not the only, painter who captured the war.
We were a group of artists, but each one in his field.
It was kind of a renaissance, you know. And I was part of this group. With my work about the streets of Beirut, I renewed Lebanese art. The Lebanese type features, etc., were not depicted. It was depicted in a, let's say, more romantic way, more impressionist way, if you want, long time ago, but never this realistic way.
Her compositions become fragmented. She divides the canvas into multiple screens like in a movie. This combination of realism and fantasy is also used by director Marum Baghdadi in film and by Ziad Rahbani in music and theater.
So we would meet, all of us together, many times and see the work of each other and then work on each other's work.
War period paintings depict the streets of Beirut. The elements in these paintings, people and buildings, seem to be floating as if uprooted from the usual order of things.
It's not only the elements that are floating in my works. People float, buildings are floating also. I think the floatings come because I feel like not only me, but everybody, is they are from this world and they are not.
You said that you painted the street that is your skin because you felt so strongly the affinity with the city of Beirut.
While I was painting it, I wanted the skin to have the same rhythm as my breathing. So I was feeling that the skin was moving as if it was breathing. Expression of what they were feeling.
Artists meet regularly to discuss each other's work and exchange ideas. Working in collaboration on each other's art, they organize performances and exhibitions attracting large audiences. Based on real life, this new art is expressing what people feel. It is like a breath of fresh air.
It was very intense also because it was all the time between two periods of bombing.
This excitement goes on for months until the Syrians invade Beirut. Then the exhibitions stop. The events that follow the invasion plunge the city into despair.
After that, it was terrible days during the invasion.
Seta's younger sister, Aline, decides to stay in Beirut. She spends all her time on the street taking photos of the shooting and bombing. At the age of 22, she is the chief photographer at Reuters. Some of her photos, published in Europe, help raise the awareness of the tragedy of the civil war in Lebanon.
But the ones that stayed, each time the shelling and the bombing stopped, we were doing exhibitions, we were going to dinners, we were having Christmas, we were having Muslim holidays, Christian holidays, we were having holidays, and the decoration was there. These devastated buildings, they had all the decorations of holidays. Between two bombing, we're going to the hairdresser. This is how we didn't die. I couldn't see the difference between me and Beirut. I was Beirut. I didn't want to leave. It was a subject of my work also. I loved everything in Beirut, the streets, the people. Tremendous need to help other people.
Seta goes to the poor neighborhoods devastated by war, distributing food supplies, clothing, and blankets, helping those in need.
I went on the border between the Christians and the Muslims there, and in the very, very poor neighborhood, I told them to come. And there was a school that was empty. So there was also tables and everything. I brought with me paper, and they started painting. They loved it. Next time I came back, they were waiting for me downstairs. They were waiting.
I like to show you the children. They were all ages. There were even this little one with, she has a pacifier on her mouth and she's drawing. You see, they don't even have shoes.
For them, it was something different than the bombing and killing.
The real casualties of any war are children. Seta compiles the children's drawings into two books, War Through the Eyes of Lebanese Children, and publishes them in 1977.
We send it to many, many countries. We send it to Europe, Russia. It was a fundraising for the poor neighborhoods to have food and blankets. This little girl's name is Wafa Saad. She was 12 years old. I like it because the sun goes inside the ocean. It sinks in the ocean. It doesn't go to the horizon.
What that Ramadan, 13 years old, is like a triptych. This is Basma Shibani. Wadad Kebbe. This is Muhammad Wazze, 10 years old. He's a Muslim, like his name Muhammad indicate. And he knew that I was a Christian. And to prove to me that he doesn't have nothing to do against my religion, he painted for me this wonderful piece.
all the crosses, to all the churches.
And this is one day when everybody was coming to buy bread from this store, bomb fell and everybody died. One of my friends, also an artist, he died that day. Najat Sharafuddin, 10 years old, did this piece.
The drawings become a powerful testimony of the atrocities of war seen through the eyes of its innocent victims.
Nabil, 10 years old, he painted a nice house with trees, everything blue and nice and red and green, and then he put black on top of everything. Wonderful piece. It is Hayat Sidawi, little girl, 13 years old. She did this like black, it represents the war and blood. And she did a Christian church and a Muslim church, and the two towers leaning toward each other. She wanted peace, you know.
Something happens once they were watching puppets. And they were laughing and laughing and laughing. Suddenly the airplanes came. They threw bombs, the airplanes. It was Israeli airplanes. So they started crying. So it was, and at the same time they were laughing for the puppets and crying for the bombs. It was incredible.
Part in several shows of Lebanese artists in Europe and the United States, exhibiting her paintings created during the Civil War in Lebanon. In 1991, she signs up with the Sherry Frumkin Gallery in Santa Monica, which features Two from Beirut, a two-artist exhibition. It is the first serious introduction of Seta's art in Los Angeles.
For me, it was such a contrast between what was happening during the war and the response of the viewers. It was different. It was completely different. Art is not a matter of life and death.
Before Seta starts to work on her new series, which she calls T-Shape, she does not work for more than a year. During that time, she gets married and divorces the same year.
When I was married, I could not work because it was a wrong marriage. My husband was an artist and there was a conflict there because he wanted to be the only artist home, this T-shape came to my mind.
The T-shape series, dated 1988 to 1992, addresses the theme of horizontality and verticality already explored in Seta's white period, painted in Lebanon.
Painting people going to their work, but placing them in a horizontal way in my painting, it means they are alive, but dead. Verticality for me is a positive. It is taking action and having more transcendence, waking up to a different dimension of yourself. Most of the people are horizontal people. They are not way to their center, to their spirituality. They don't have this awareness. So in general, people live and love and get married and go to work and go to the restaurant, and suddenly you wake up. You start to say, no, it's not that. Life is not that. In these paintings, they're all men, the T-shaped period. I didn't want to put a woman vertically because otherwise it's going to be a gender conflict. I just wanted to avoid that. In spite of that, they started thinking about gender conflict. So it's been avoided. There was this vertical man and the horizontal man, and then later it became a circle with a man that is trying to kind of go inside the circle, be part of the circle.
Two from Beirut is followed by two personal exhibitions, The Practical Use of Desire in 1992 and Familiar Fire in 1995. The new work marks a significant departure from her past figurative paintings, created during the Civil War in Lebanon and later during the T-shaped period in Los Angeles. This new work deals with her coming back to life after 10 years of war.
One day I was feeling like a fire inside of me. Literally, I saw the fire as if I was seeing it with my eyes. Fire was coming from inside, it was real fire. So I thought, what to do? I'm going to burn something in the middle of a gallery, maybe. Let's put fire. And then I cooled down a little bit. I thought I bring red, anything red. Hmm. I went and bought a big bunch of red flowers and put them in my car. And I started putting them on a piece of wood for days and days. This red. Until the fire was extinguished.
Seta feels the dryness of the freeways in Los Angeles, which she identifies with her own state of mind. And she has a strong desire to water them.
I had to give life again to myself.
Seta creates several paintings in assemblage with bread. Loaves of bread, burned to black in the lower part of compositions, are juxtaposed against fresh loaves in the upper part. Seta is burying the past, burying the war. These organic shapes in Seta's paintings and sculptures look like blood vessels. They signify life-giving force.
It was all about coming back to life.
During the 1995 exhibition, Familiar Fire, Seta comes up with an idea for an art performance based on her dream as a reflection of her experience during the war.
They started going everywhere, and the militiamen started running them, and they looked like cowboys. And my bed is in the street, because all the belongings of people are in the street. Everything is displaced. Also, my father is on a trip. Well, it was this movie, Egyptian movie. It was two people kissing on the billboard. And the movie's name was My Father on a Tree. Nobody saw the movie because the whole movie theater was bombed. Only the billboard remained. It was like a kind of a symbol about the craziness of the world.
Abstract vertical series with a vertical line in the center of compositions around which life force energies are engaged in dynamic color configurations arising from the emptiness of the white canvas.
I needed that line in the middle. Some people call it axis mundi or the creator if you want. For me, it is my center. Mind, the ego mind that is talking. We don't go in concentration deeper levels of the mind. And if we go very deep, we find silence. And this silence, it is the white canvas or the white paper. And everything is superimposed on it. So this silence, this emptiness, is essential part of everything. I like to say though that lately I have been thinking about this vertical line, and I was thinking this is also a concept. We don't need a center in reality. Everywhere is a center, nowhere is a center. The first years in Los Angeles were so painful, so difficult that I completely forgot. I was busy. I was not in touch with the feelings I have of love or anything else. So I was driving. I said, I'd like to have my heart filled with love again, you know. 1 week later, I met my teacher. And I started going deeper and deeper into meditation.
While spending long hours in meditation, Seta begins contemplating the idea of going to Sri Lanka to further study Dharma, the teachings of the Buddha. Under Bhante Lakana's guidance, Seta attends meditation classes and studies Buddhism. She goes to several meditation retreats and meets with visiting monks.
Is it important for you to feel that somebody likes what you do?
Of course. Of course, I have always been very happy when somebody loves my work or appreciates it. I was very happy. But now, I don't mind anymore. I don't.
In 2005, Seta takes her training to the next level. With the blessing of Bhante Lakana, she decides to travel to the monastery in Delgoda, Sri Lanka, where she is expected to study under the tutelage of the Venerable Premasiri, who is also Bhante Lakana's teacher. She announces to her family and friends that she is leaving.
I respect your choice, and I know exactly what you're doing, but for me, I cannot relate because I don't meditate and I'm not in a spiritual world. I'm in a material world. And I can only see you physically going away. I know that when the phone rings, it's not going to be you anymore. It's for me, it's the physical, material world that is my world. I cannot see things otherwise. Even I'm being a little bit detached from emotions because I'm so overwhelmed by the material world that even my emotional world is I'm being detached from. I feel like I'm, you know, like your paintings, the horizontal and vertical. I feel like I'm in a horizontal state right now. And I'm trying to be as detached as possible. This is the first time I cry since you announced this to me. I try to stay completely detached and all of a sudden it hits me, you know? And it hasn't hit me yet. I mean, it's hitting right now a little bit. But
Baba, yes, Sri Lanka, bir yer tam. İnç kumatarsız yer tam.
Yes, harim var. O yer mek azade. Ambem mek anahat. İn yankı kazma gerbelu yağın kuri. Yağın ku çürüm arkelelu. Yes, inci yete arsız. Yes, çem servor tun şirak çampo edevetar. İm arkel kenarovuz. Vay yapan çerpok ver.
Baba, Kristo'nun ayetiyen tempan mı çi imradız? Bazen biz mitki makbulçan hamar gertem gör, araçan alu.
Prinsipi, Kristo'nun ya hay Kristo'nun ya iyi gelse o mekçan aziz, kınut ya aziz, hay Lusa Orçagan ından ikimi zavagınız. Pokhele ıntarra biz kişimi hort kıtırı.
Pokhele çıga baba?
Pokhele çıga selam pokhvazı.
Et moi, je vais aller dans un pays très loin.
Ouais. Et comment ça s'appelle?
Ça s'appelle le Sri Lanka.
Oh.
Tu connais?
Non.
C'est très très loin. C'est à côté de l'Inde. C'est au sud de l'Inde. Et là-bas, je vais devenir une nonne. Tu sais ce que c'est une nonne? Est-ce que tu as jamais vu à la télévision des femmes et des hommes qui portent quelque chose comme ça de long?
Ah, des robes?
Oui, comme un sari, long, comme ça, marron, ou couleur ocre, comme ça dessus. L'autre couleur ocre, c'est un peu orange, un peu comme la couleur de la terre.
Ah oui.
Oui? Oui?
Ça ressemble à du marron.
Voilà, et ils ont la tête chauve.
Ah oui, ça c'est les bouddhismes.
Oui, c'est ça. Et je serai chauve, ça ne te dérange pas?
Non, ça va.
Ça va, hein? L'autre jour, tu me disais, ah, c'est ta garde, tes cheveux. Et...
Mais
c'est pas grave, n'est-ce pas? Tu as eu le temps de réfléchir.
As a tribute to their teacher and to honor her decision to go to the Far East, Seta's art students and colleagues prepare an East Indian dance at the annual graduation ceremony and ask her to participate.
Empty space. I was very happy here. Terrific studio for an artist. Light was perfect, everything. If you are peaceful, this place becomes really paradise. But if you have problems, this place could become hell. It's not the place that is important.
It is a long 22-hour flight to Kuala Lumpur and another 4 hours to Colombo, the capital of Sri Lanka.
I'm going to meet a really good teacher.
I'm very excited about it.
Although Colombo stretches along the west coast of the island, it was lucky to have been spared by the tsunami of 2004. Buddhism, introduced to Sri Lanka in the 3rd century BC, transcends the superficial idea of tourism. It is the national philosophy and a way of life, one that we can hear, taste, and touch, which gives the country its unique atmosphere. Delgoda, with its places of worship and monasteries, looks serene. Everything seems solitary and simple. Seta is briefly welcomed by the Venerable Premissary and escorted to her kuti. In the morning, there is the distant sound of a gong. Women eat in simple silence, contemplating each movement.
I cannot tell you how much. I never imagined in my wildest dreams that I'm in such a beautiful place. It's wonderful.
How many hours a day do you meditate?
Right now I am doing 6-7 hours, sitting and walking, sitting and walking. I just try to watch the thought that is coming, you know, and then let it pass without regrets, without clinging to it, without pursuing, without analyzing, just watching it come and go. I have all these brushes now in front of me. They're incredibly beautiful brushes. But right now I don't feel like painting. Even though they are like incredible. Look at this one. Look at this one. Uh-huh. And this one. I'm gonna try to don't have like attachment for them or any desire to paint right now. I want to do meditation seriously, very seriously now. I put all my mindfulness in it.
After hours of meditation and independent studies during the day, Seta attends the Venerable Premissary's classes in the afternoon.
Okay, දින්න එතකොට අතත් ක්‍රියාත්මකයි මේක ඔයා සතුටින් පරිහරණය කරන්න කියලා වචනෙත් හොඳයි පරිහරණය කළා ඔයාට එපා වෙච්චාම ඕන නම් තව කෙනෙකුට දෙන්න කියලා කියන්න පුළුවන් මොකද මිනිස්සු පුරුදු වෙලාම තියෙනවා දුන්නාම මේ බලාපොරොත්තු වෙයි ඒ දුන්න එක්කෙනාගේ හිත හතුට කරන්න පරිහරණය කියලා ලබාපු එක්කෙනා හිතනවා එහෙම මහා වදයක් ඒක එයාට දැන් ඒක තේරෙනවා වයස 24ක් ඉතිර ඇති මට මේ ඉන්දියන් රෙද්දක් ගෙනල්ලා දෙපඩ තිබුණක් මහලා මට එකක් දුන්නා මේක නායකානුක මේක ආය වෙන තිවුරු ගන්න බෑ ඔයාට මැරෙනකම්ම මේක තමයි ඒ විදිහම තිවුරක් I think then මම එදාසල මේ විසුද්ධි මාර්ගය ඉගෙන ගන්න ඉතින් දැන් මගේ එක එක්කෙනා තිවුර පොරොපු දාසට අහන කවුද දුන්නේ ඔක එහෙන ප්‍රශ්නයක් මට දැන් විදින නෑනේ ඕම එක දැන් මේක එහෙම තියාගන්නත් බෑ මං කල්පනා මේක සාධාරණයක් ගොඩක් තවත් තිබුණා කපුස් සිවුර බුරුම සිවුරු සිවුරක් කොයි අඳන්නේ කොයි තනි කොට ඒකත් හරිම වටිනවා ඔව් දැන් මම මේ සිවුරු තුනම එකතු එකට වුණා දැන් ඒකට පාන්දර තුනට ඉතර ගිහින් දැන් මම සිවුරු ටික බෝඩ් එකක් ලියලා මේ දුටු කෙනෙක් පාංශු කුල වශයෙන් ගණිත්වා කියලා. දැන් මම මාත් ඉන්න පාට යනවා කිව්ද. නම් ලියලා නැහැ මේක. ලොකු වර දැන් අතෙන් තියෙන කුණු කොට වගේ කුණු කොටක් තියෙනවා. දැන් ඉතින් අර සිවුරු පොරවා යනකොට එක එක්කෙනා නෝයාට කොහෙන්ද? පාංශු කුල වශයෙන් ගත්තා. අයියෝ මේක පාංශු කුල වශයෙන් දැම මොඩයා කවුද? ඔය ඉතින් මේ දහරි ප්‍රාන්නේ දැන් ඔක නාය ගහන්නන් තිකිය සිවුර පාංගු කුල වශයෙන් විසුවලා දෙකේ ලැබ මදි ඔව් කිව්වා මොක කියන නාය කන්න හිනව නැතර ඊට පස්සේ එච්චර හොඳ සිවුරක් මේ ජීවිතේ තවම හම්බ වෙලා නැහැ
Meditation, when you suffer from a pain on your legs or any on your back or any pains you have, and you don't cling to it, you don't react to it, or also could be a pleasant sensation, you don't react to it at all. And not reacting, anyways, I have to say that the pain amplifies as if in under a magnifier when you are meditating, but if you don't do any clinging to it, just watching it, then wisdom arises. This is pain, this is body, so they are completely separate, and there is no self, there is no self that is experiencing that pain, so this is wisdom. The yogi is not clinging to anything, he gets rid to all concepts. Art has concepts, but here no concepts whatsoever. And you go to truth, ultimate truth. Artist also clings to beauty, clings to sound and to colors, to beauty. In meditation, you should not cling to anything.
Bhagavan Sama Sambuddhasse
What is the name of the place where we're going?
Buena Vista Cave.
And the name of the monk?
We're the name of the monk is Bhikkhu Sumedha.
That you have here have a round shape, almost.
Most all have round shapes.
And there is an egg also.
Yeah.
And the elephant is round.
Yeah.
The monkey is round.
Yeah. Because I think the circle is the closest to what's existent, what is not man-made. But I think the only shape who is really natural is the spiral. Even our analytical knowledge of language is having a spiral movement. And the symbol of the Buddha here, we call Urma Roma Dhatu, is a spiral. It is in fact a nautical spiral, based upon the same natural phenomena as the snail shells. It goes and opens. And the calibration of these seashells is based upon aesthetics for the human beings. We would say that they are calibrated in the Fibonacci numbers. The liberation movement is a spiral. It takes always from behind as an accomplishment. It takes into the next chamber calibration. The highest knowledge is the knowledge that you know that you are liberated. No? How can it be otherwise? As it is a law of nature to swim against the stream if you want to cross. You have crossed to three quarter upwards, then of course you can take it a little easier to the other side.
Thank you.